الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا
إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده سبحانه نستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ونبيه ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ثم أما بعد أشهد أن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي وأفضل الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ونعوذ بالله تعالى من عذابه ومن سخطه من النار. Begin by praising Allah the Most High, the Most Exalted, the Most Merciful, the Most Magnificent, the Most Honorable. We testify to His oneness, His greatness, the King of the universe, the master of everything we know and everything we don't. We testify Him and to Him alone as our one and only deity. We testify to the prophethood of His most beloved, the last man He sent to guide humanity, the last human that spoke to Him directly, Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, the son of Abdul Muttalib. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to bless Prophet Muhammad, to bless his family, to bless his community, and to bless all those who accept and follow his guidance until the end of time. We testify and bear witness that the best of words on this earth are the words of Allah in His glorious book, the Quran. And the best of guidance, the best of teaching, the best of mentorship is that of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And everything that leads us astray from those two great things leads us to the hellfire. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect us and our families and those that we love from the punishment and the wrath of Allah and the hellfire. My brothers and sisters, today's khutbah will be a session on a review. Many times when we were growing up, if you remember, for the elders or the youngsters, you always take usually a very large exam, a big exam, an important exam during the year. And after that exam is over, everybody's in anticipation. Everybody's nervous about what grade they got on that exam. Everybody's a little bit worried. They studied, they did hard, they tried their best, but they want to know what they got on the exam. So the day comes where they will sit down in class and the teacher will give out the grades to every person. And some people, they will get their grade and they'll be so happy. Their faces will be so full of bliss. And some people, they'll get their grades and they'll be so upset. They'll say to themselves, I tried so hard, but this is the grade I got. And some people will see a failing grade, and they'll say, doesn't mean much to me, that's fine. I didn't really study, I don't really care. I'm not really doing anything, who cares? Subhanallah, different types of attitudes towards the grade that we give it in a simple class. So today, inshallah ta'ala, the khutbah is going to start with a rubric. A rubric of the answers, you know, as this teacher gives out the test and then she sits down or he sits down and he starts to go over the answers. Question one, what was the answer and why was that right? Question two, question three, question four, question 10, question 15. People are asking, people are delayed, people are delayed, but we're trying to find out why we got this grade. Did we get this grade? How did we get this grade? What did we understand out of this grade, out of this test? So Allah Azza wa Jalla, my brothers and sisters, He gave us 30 days of a major exam. A very, very important exam. And it's an exam that only comes once a year. 30 days, 30 days in the year. And so we want to know what our grade is. What did we get? How did we do? A week after Ramadan is gone, what is your grade of Ramadan? How did you feel? And so, inshallah ta'ala, let's go through the rubric. What were the goals of Ramadan? What were we trying to achieve out of Ramadan, and did we achieve them? And so the first thing is to go to what Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us about Ramadan. The first goal of Ramadan. Ya ayyuhal ladheena aamanu. These are the only sets of verses about Ramadan in the Quran. We've covered them, alhamdulillah, in the past three khutbas, and today we end them. What were the goals of the past three khutbas? What were the means? What did we try to achieve? What were the answers of Ramadan? Number one, ya ayyuhal ladheena aamanu. Kutiba alaykum as-siyam. We all know the verses. Oh, you believe it was prescribed for you to fast. 30 days of fasting. 29 days actually this year of fasting. 29 days we woke up and we didn't eat from sunrise to sunset. 29 days. What was the goal of that? What is the number one thing Allah wanted us to get from that? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you can attain taqwa. Number one, scale on the answer sheet. Number one, did you gain taqwa? Did you attain taqwa? Did you get closer to taqwa? And subhanAllah, again, we can go through many matrices of what taqwa is. Again, these things are not just subjective things Allah tells us. Allah talks about taqwa a lot in the Quran. But Allah doesn't just leave it up in the air, like, figure it out. You guys figure out if you have it or not. Allah gives us metrics. He gives us simple things that we measure ourselves. My brethren, brothers and sisters, we need to be in the constant habit of measuring and assessing ourselves. Testing ourselves. Where are we? Where are we in life? Where are we in our relationship with Allah? Where are we in taqwa? In our level of taqwa? Where are we? On a scale of 0 to 100, where are we? So you go back to what Allah has given. What are the metrics Allah has gives you for taqwa? And we mention them, and it's the first page of the Quran. Allah has given. You don't have to go look too far. You can just go to the first page. The first page gives you a metric system for many pages later what Ramadan should give you out of taqwa. The first set of metrics for attaining taqwa also talks about the importance of Ramadan. We said Ramadan is about Quran. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah Al-Baqarah beginning, Alif Lam Mim, Dalika Kitab, La Rayba Fi. This is the book, the Quran. It is the book that there's no doubt about. It's the last book and there's no doubt about it. هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It came, as we said, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنَ هُدَى. Right? We said that 2 weeks ago, we talked about this. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is now telling us, this is the book, it is guidance. لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. To those that have taqwa. The goal of Ramadan was taqwa, right? The Quran and the month of Ramadan should attain taqwa. SubhanAllah. Allah Azza wa Jalla is extremely organized in the way He sets up His discussion in the Quran. It's not haphazard. It's amazingly perfect. جَلَّ فِي عُلَى. So we say to ourselves, to know that لِلْمُتَّقِينَ هُدًى ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It is guidance for al-muttaqeen. Who are al-muttaqeen? Did we attain taqwa? Are we of them? Here are the categories. Number one, أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those that believe in the unseen. الْغَيْبِ. Those that believe in things that they don't see. Al-Ghayb, of course, there's many things here that are Al-Ghayb, but mainly they are Allah and the angels, the messengers of Allah, and the humans that we have not seen Allah sent to earth, the prophets, and the Day of Judgment, the hereafter, and Qadr, decree, as Allah Azza wa Jalla has perfected it in ways that we can't see and don't know. These are the five things, subhanAllah, they are linked to Iman. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. And the Prophet ﷺ, again, the wisdom of Islam, my brothers and sisters, is building people. The number one rubric is Iman. What did the Prophet ﷺ say about Ramadan? مَنْ صَامَ رَمَضَانَ مَنْ قَامَ رَمَضَانَ مَنْ قَامَ لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا. They all link, subhanAllah. Everything links together. So iman is the number one rubric of taqwa. Did your iman increase in Ramadan? How much did your iman, the iman in al-ghayb here, how much did your iman, your faith in Allah, improve in Ramadan? Meaning, like, how much closer did you get to Allah in Ramadan? Like, how much more do you believe in Allah now? How much more are you convinced about the greatness of Allah, the mercy of Allah, the power of Allah? How much more closer are you towards the forgiveness of Allah, or the abilities of Allah, or the beauty of Allah? Whatever you want out of your relationship with Allah, did you improve? Do you feel closer to Allah? Do you feel like there's a deeper sense of purpose towards your relationship between you and Allah? These are, again, questions that we have to ask ourselves. We're trying to improve ourselves. We're trying to grow and become better. Our iman is number one. How is our relationship with Allah? Of course, the angels, the prophets, and that's all good. Here, I want to link another part of the ghayb. The day of judgment. Iman al-wahdisaban, right? Iman al-wahdisaban. Iman is belief in Allah and the other things that Allah has, they mentioned. And ihtisab comes from the reward you expect from Allah. Like, that's your conviction in the day of judgment. And by the way, Allah will refer to this again a little bit later. But what is, did your conviction in the next life improve? When you didn't eat and drink, did you say to yourself, man, I feel strong. Like, I feel closer. You know, you can go around people, they're like, why aren't you eating and drinking? I was sitting next to a woman in the plane. Why don't you get a drink or something? Like, no. Fasting. So I'm like, it links that I'm fasting for Allah. I'm fasting for a reward. I'm fasting for ajr. I'm fasting for mercy. I am closer in my relationship to Allah while I'm fasting. And I'm closer to understanding that my end goal of life is that I will meet Allah in the day of judgment. It is a higher conviction of iman. Did your iman increase during Ramadan? Did you feel it increase? And of course, that's kind of a given answer, right? But is it at somewhere near that level still today? We're a week later. But do you still feel like your iman is high? That's a good metric. Number one. Number two, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. And they establish prayer. So now, subhanAllah, Islam is not theory without practice. So iman, the belief system, the strong convictions in your heart should result in something. What do the first thing that they should result in? Your salah. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. Those that they don't just make prayer. They are on top of their game when it comes to prayer. They're on their game. So if you ask yourself now, like, how many salahs have we missed since Ramadan? How many salahs have we not caught in the masjid since Ramadan? I mean, these are personal questions, right? I'm not telling you to tell anybody. Maybe you should have a group of people, like usra, halqa, a group of people that you're trying to grow with, and you should tell them. But since 1 week after Ramadan, it's been 1 week, how's our salah during Eid? How's our salah after Eid? How's our coming to the masjid? Since Eid, since Ramadan. How is it? I mean, these are important questions. How's our Fajr and Isha in the masjid since Ramadan? These are all important metrics. And by the way, maybe we've struggled a little bit. That's okay. But the idea is that you know, yeah, my grade is not that good. Like, I got a 60. I got a 70. My salah's a 50. My salah's a 30. I need to do some work. That's okay. Bad grades just tell you they're just an opportunity for you to get better. But as long as you're measuring yourself, you're committing yourself to something in salah that you're establishing. So this really important, aqam salah. Your fara'id, are you doing them? Your sunnah that you were doing before. And of course, the fara'id, they're tough. Sometimes you're distracted, you miss out, you know, this and that. Something happens in salah. Dhuhr, asr, maghrib, isha. Something happens, that's cool. How's your sunnah since Ramadan? Like, oh man, I was distracted a little bit in Ramadan. Let me make sure to knock out the sunnah right now. How's your sunnah of fajr? How's your sunnah of maghrib? How's your sunnah? Like, how is your salah? Your iman increased, but was your salah, they have to correspond together. Allah Azza wa Jalla puts it that way, I didn't. This is what Allah tells us. How is your iman? If your iman increased, so the first metrics is your salah. How's your salah been? And subhanAllah, here I want to make an important point about coming to the masjid and about the attitudes that we develop in coming to the masjid. And subhanAllah, many times, of course, especially in Ramadan, I mean, Isha is so important in Ramadan, subhanAllah, right? Isha is like, you're making Isha in Ramadan. But subhanAllah, Isha and Fajr specifically, they're always really important to make. I mean, they are a good metrics. If you're an activist, if you're you're a leader, if you're working for the community, I mean, you should first look at your Isha and Fajr in the masjid. Like, that's your first barometer. Man, we can't change the world if we can't even come to the masjid for Isha and Fajr. We can't free Palestine, we can't do anything, we can't guide anybody. If our metrics is messed up, and again, maybe we have shortcomings, that's fine. Ramadan reminds us about what we can do. And so we're just trying to make sure that we're still doing this. We're still on top of this. This is very, very important. And here, one small note about coming to the masjid in Ramadan. We make it very, very, very dangerous, my brothers and sisters, the way we treat the masjid in Ramadan. It's as if Ramadan is the time where you come to the masjid and you have to act religious. You have to act different. But subhanAllah, taqwa is not about acting differently for certain moments. For example, we always link, and this is something I see all the time, we always link the way we dress when we come to the masjid, to the masjid. So when I go to the masjid, I put my black abaya on, or I put my white thobe on, and I go to the masjid. My iman is high, my taqwa is high, I'm praying. It's really good. But then when I leave, like I go to school, I go to work, I wear different clothes. So I feel like, hey, you know, it's okay. I'm not religious right now. I'm not supposed to have that much taqwa right now. I'm not supposed to be at that level of iman right now, right? It's supposed to be different. That's why I'm very against this costume that we wear in Ramadan when we come to the masjid. Costume, what I mean, wear the kufi, wear the jalabiya, you wear the abaya, and you gain taqwa. You associate with the masjid this relationship of taqwa. But then when you go outside, abaya comes off, thobe comes off, your manners come off, your iman comes off, your level of taqwa that you have in the masjid, it comes off too. Allah has done a more important, and that's why I prefer, personal. Now this is not a fatwa or anything, but I prefer to wear normal clothes when I come to the masjid, the same clothes I wear outside. I don't want to give a different association to clothes when I'm in the masjid and when I'm outside the masjid, because taqwa is something that's not in the clothes. وَلِبَاسُ التَّقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ. The libas of taqwa, meaning the spiritual libas, the clothing, is much more important than the physical clothing. If you wear a thobe and you come to the masjid, you feel more iman, and you take it off and you feel like, I have less iman. I have less taqwa. Don't wear a thobe, bro. Don't wear an abaya. Who said sisters? Many times sisters come to the masjid, they don't have their hijab on. They come to the masjid, they put their hijab on. It's cool, it's good to honor the masjid, that's cool. But when you take it off, like, it's less taqwa now? Is there anything in the Quran or the Sunnah that says women shouldn't come to the masjid without hijab? I mean, if we're associating something with Ramadan and coming to the masjid and we have this taqwa and then we take it off and then we take off our taqwa with it, then let's not change our clothing. Let's keep our clothing the same so that the important thing is the taqwa, not the clothing. Not the attitude, not the feeling. We need to associate positive things to taqwa, and specifically the masjid and establishing prayer. Now, I don't mean to get on the soapbox, but that's really important. My three-year-old, and I give you a small example, my three-year-old, she loves to wear dresses. She wears a dress every day. And she always tells me, Baba, I look beautiful. And she's 3 years old, I try to associate with her beauty. Baba, you're beautiful when you listen to what Mama tells you. That's beautiful. It's not the dress. It's not what you wear. Taqwa is not what you wear. It's what's in your heart. Very, very important relationship we should have with the masjid and salah is that taqwa is what's inside of us, this iman that we built. أَلَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Third metrics of taqwa. This is still, we're still on taqwa. Third metrics of taqwa. وَالَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ. Those that spend what we have given them. They, الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ. Those that spend from the risk that Allah Azza wa Jalla gave them. You know one of the things, subhanAllah, risk is a very wide term. Of course we associate it with money, and I'll focus on money first. After Ramadan you gave all your money away, you know what people say, subhanAllah, sadaqah is real tough right now. Brother, don't ask for sadaqah after the masjid. I hope you guys don't have a fundraiser right now, because I'm broke. As if sadaqah now has also been associated with Ramadan. Like when Ramadan is here, I give my sadaqah, my zakat. When Ramadan is over, I'm broke. See, there's again a relationship between action and taqwa. Your salat, Allah has said, وَمِنَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. They are always giving whatever they have. Number one here, number one thing we should learn after Ramadan is that if you feel, brother or sister, you're a little bit broke in your sadaqah expenses after Ramadan, go out and make more money so you can spend more for the sake of Allah. Like, don't be lazy and say, خلاص, you know, I'm broke. Go out and find another revenue stream. Go out and get a higher position in your company. Go out and build, if you have if you have one restaurant, what's wrong with not opening 2 or 3 or 4? Like, when did Muslims become so lazy in increasing their وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ? Like, we want to limit what Allah has given us. Go out, Allah says after Salat al-Jum'ah. After, وَإِذَا قُضِيَ بِالصَّلَاةِ. When the Salat is over, فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Get the heck out. Like, go. وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. And make some more, like, make some more money. What's wrong with you? Don't just sit. We sit around after Jum'ah, everybody's kissing and hugging, and another has nothing to do. Like, Allah tells us after Salat al-Jum'ah, go out and make money. وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهِ. And remember Allah. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Like, you can be more successful. But go out and be more successful. Go out and do it. Go out and make more money. So if Ramadan, if this Ramadan you gave $1,000 to Salat or $10,000, next Ramadan you should make $20,000. Like, I'm gonna figure out a way to double my income so I can give $20,000. Not many people. After Ramadan, next year they give 10, they give 8. They give Ramadan after 6. Then Ramadan, kids are in college, 4. SubhanAllah, we are going in reverse. What Allah is telling us, real taqwa is you're constantly giving. You're constantly spending. In the 4th year, something else when it comes to rizq is that we should also. Rizq is not just money. It's any abilities that Allah has given us to serve Him. Right? That's really rizq. Health, youth, abilities, skills, whatever that is. So after Ramadan is over, now that Ramadan is over, this is a level of taqwa that you have to measure yourself. What was it in Ramadan that you figured out about yourself? When you removed, like, you know, we're always worried about breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and clash of plans. Okay, Ramadan, you remove that. So what are you doing with life, bro? Like, where are you going? What has Allah given you that you're serving His deen? Did you figure that out in Ramadan? When you weren't worried about breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Like, food was out of the way. So, what did you figure out about how you serve the deen of Allah? How you're giving back to your community? Did you figure it out? And if you didn't, you should figure that out. Because وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ means you are constantly spending, earning blood, sweat, tears, money for whatever Allah has given you of blessings. You're spending it for the sake of Allah. وَالَّذِينَ. And then, of course, very quickly, the metrics is over. We're still talking about taqwa. Taqwa is iman, then salah. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنْزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. So now, here, revelation. What is our relationship with revelation during Ramadan? And did we sustain it now? So the Quran, last time we read it? Last week? Was the last time we opened the Quran last week? Was the last time we read a page of Quran? Last Thursday? Last one of the odd nights? The 27th night? The 25th? When was the last time we opened up a page of Quran to read? You're asking yourself, SubhanAllah, that's your measure of taqwa. When was the last time you prayed? Contemplated of Quran, you said a verse of Quran. Your relationship with the Book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Again, Ramadan was about the Quran. So what is your relationship with the Quran? I don't have a lot of time. So go to the last one. And the last thing, وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. During Ramadan, did your akhirah yaqeen get at a higher level? Did you feel like, subhanAllah, hasanat, I feel the hasanat by Allah. SubhanAllah, when you're breaking your fast, you feel like, subhanAllah, it's heavy in the scale. When you're making your qiyam, subhanAllah, you feel that your scales are getting heavy. When you're doing hasanat, it's like, oh, that was 70 times more. It feels good. But the idea was, Ramadan is an event to keep you going. But consistency keeps you growing. And Allah gives us moments to get us very charged up. But really, it is the consistency in what we do after that keeps us growing. So how is our relationship with the akhirah been since Ramadan is passed? Have we increased it? Again, the test, it's in your lap. I can't tell you. You can't tell me and I can't tell you. But the question is, has our relationship with the akhirah increased? Have we looked, we're on Snapchat and we saw something. We're on Instagram and something came up. You're on an email, you're walking by the mall, you're at Eid, whatever. Like, did something happen to you and you say, Al-Akhirah, man, like I'm gonna die, I need this hasanat, I'm afraid of Allah's punishment. I'm afraid Allah holds me accountable. I'm afraid Allah doesn't accept my tawbah. I'm afraid Allah will expose me in front of people. Like, that's a relationship with the akhirah that you have to constantly have. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَى هُدًى. These people are our guides. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه غفور رحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Again, my brothers and sisters, today, khutbah today is just the rubric for the test that we have there in the 30 days, the 29 days of Ramadan. What is the rubric that Allah Azzajal measures the goals of Ramadan? How have we attained them? Where are we on the scale? How do we measure ourselves all individually? And again, the first goal, again, as we mentioned, is taqwa. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. And we went through the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, and I urge you, wallahi, the Qur'an, the month of the Qur'an, its meaning and purpose was that you dive into it. Not that you're just reading letters. That's not the point of the Qur'an, that you're just reading letters. That you are going through the Qur'an and you're saying to yourself, Ya Allah, I'm about to read the Qur'an and measure myself where I'm supposed to be. As subhanAllah, you don't get off the first page with Allah telling you, this is how you should be. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. How are you? How are you doing? This is the first page. It starts, and the entire Quran, the purpose of the Quran is to make you a better person. Is to make this family, your family, a better family. To make this community a better community. To make the world a better world. That's what the goal of the Quran is. It's very simple. And so when we go through the Quran, we should be reading it like, this is my exam and I'm trying to test myself. I'm trying to grow myself. I'm trying to grow myself. Because growth is one of the most important things in life that leads to happiness and success. That you are constantly measuring yourself and growing. That is one of the most beautiful things about life. When people are constantly growing, that's what Allah Azza wants us to constantly do. Just grow. So events, like I said, like Ramadan, they keep you going. But consistency and discipline keeps you growing. So we were asking, how much have we grown? Allah has given the second goal of Ramadan, and I'll cut it short. So he said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, and we put the matrix, the metrics. Now we are on, لِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. The second, the end of the second set of verses, the second verse, is لِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. By the way, Allah has just told us, الْمُتَّقِينَ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَى هُدَى. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, لِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. Like the Qur'an and Allah's purpose was to guide you. So how good have you been guided? And you should praise Allah and glorify Allah in being guided. And here, لِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ, many meanings of the scholars they give, of course, the takbir of Eid, the takbirat of Eid, you're making your adhan, making your salat, all of these beautiful things. And again, we mentioned salat. And here, the focus that I want to focus on for the end of the khutbah, وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So that you can be more thankful. So that you can be more thankful. And here, a very, very important analogy when it comes to thankfulness. Thankfulness, my brothers and sisters, are not words on the tongue. Same as taqwa. They're not just things that we say. They are also metrics for thankfulness. The metrics that I want you to focus in on is, what have you continued to do after Ramadan? That's the true measurement of thankfulness. I'll give you an example. If your wife cooks a beautiful meal for you every day, and you kiss her on the cheek, you tell her, honey, darling, I love you so much. I'm so thankful for how much work and effort you put into dinner. After a week, 2 months, 2 years, 20 years of marriage, it doesn't mean anything anymore, right? It doesn't mean anything anymore. She tells you, if you want to be thankful, wash the dishes. If you want to be thankful, take me out to dinner 3 times a week. If you want to be thankful, put it to work where my daughter comes up to me and she wants to ask me for anything. So I tell her, you know, again, I'm giving the analogies. You know, tell my daughter, she wants something. So what my daughter does is she'll praise you a lot. So she wants a certain gift for me. So she says, Baba, I love you. Baba, you mean so much to me. Baba, this, Baba, that, Baba, this. After all, you know what I tell her? Baba, you better be good. Listen to what Baba says. Do actions. Speak louder than words. We always,
It's a very famous thing. We always say actions speak louder words. Well, when it comes to لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ, see, actions to Allah Azza wa Jalla, they mean much more than words. We can tell Allah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, thank you, shukran, shukran, all day and night, and that's good. But what does it mean if it's just words and there's no action? So if we were so thankful for Allah to give us Ramadan and hopefully forgive us of our sins and hopefully to elevate our race agenda, that's all nice. But what if we continue to do for Allah after Ramadan? That is a true barometer of thankfulness. So let's start with the two basic things. Number one, and Allah, the Prophet continues to urge us on these. Two things, and these are the things I want you to focus on in being more thankful for Allah for this Ramadan. Because Ramadan is an honor to be privileged to have experience. So how can you be more thankful? Number one, you make Qiyam al-Layl every night of Ramadan. Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, wa'alam, Jibreel told the Prophet, wa'alam anna sharaf al-mu'min qiyamu bil-layl. Your honor as an individual, your honor as an ummah, our honor as a community, number one is found in Qiyam al-Layl. And you might say to yourself, wait a minute, Qiyam is a tough thing. No. One of the first commandments after Iman, that the Ummah, that Allah Azza wa Jalla brought up the Ummah that changed the world. And one of their first commandments was, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلُ قُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. All you who are of the Prophet and his Ummah, stand for a part of the night, except for a little bit. Stand up at night and pray. I tell you, subhanAllah, 30 days or 20 days of Ramadan, people did not miss Qiyam. The first night of after Ramadan, did we miss Qiyam? Like, was it that? Nothing will revive our ummah except what brought it to greatness in the beginning. The first thing that brought it to greatness was Qiyam al-Layl. I tell you another thing. The first moments that the Prophet came to Medina and he established the best, greatest civilization in history, the first address he told them, the first presidential address of the Prophet, he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, وَأَطْعِمُ الطَّعَامُ وَصَلُّ الْأَرْحَامُ وَصَلُّ بِالنَّيْلِ. The first one of the first commandments to the new civilization, a presidential address to the new regime. Make sure you pray at night. Make sure even two rak'ahs, man, those 10 minutes of sleep that you're trying to run to, two rak'ahs that are 10 minutes are worth so much more. Two rak'ahs. Before you leave the masjid, even if you want to make it a masjid, before you leave the masjid, you want to pray those two rak'ahs of qiyam, do it. But continue your qiyam at night. Nothing will bring honor and revive our ummah more than what brought it to revive and greatness in the beginning. And one of those things was qiyam al-layl. And we are reminded of that in Ramadan. Two simple rak'ahs, 5 minutes, just bang it out. Especially, if you're a leader, if you're working, if you're volunteering, then those two rak'ahs are worth more than everything. And many hadith on Qiyam al-Layl, we will mention that maybe at another time. The second thing is fasting. Continue as-sawm li. Fasting is for me. And I reward for it. I give the reward for it. Fasting doesn't only happen in Ramadan. That's why the 6 days of Shawwal. Shawwal give you a great honor. The 3 days of the full moon are a great honor. Mondays and Thursdays are a great honor. Whatever little you can do. But it's really important to continue those two main things. Our consistency in just these two things is the highest barometer of us being thankful to Allah Azza wa Jalla. For Ramadan, for the guidance, for everything. Just these two things. Qiyam al-Layl. As simple and as little as possible, that's fine. And fasting, at least the 6 days of Shawwal. Those are the things that show your true thankfulness to Allah Azza wa Jalla. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Continue to serve and worship Allah Azza wa Jalla. Not at the same level, that's not the point. Even the Prophet didn't worship Allah at the same level. Meaning, the Prophet said the last night to stay up all night, you brought that back down, went back to sleep. Went back to, yeah, it's normal. But continue the consistency to tell Allah Azza wa Jalla that you are truly thankful for the blessing He has given you. And the honor that He has bestowed upon you through Ramadan. And so we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to have accepted our Ramadan, to to have increased our taqwa in the month of Ramadan, to have increased our iman in the month of Ramadan, to have allowed us to have a better relationship with our salah through the month of Ramadan, to have a better relationship in spending our life for a sake through the month of Ramadan. We ask Allah to make us of those that are constantly thankful to Him, that are constantly working for His sake, that are constantly giving back as little and as much, as little as we can, for His sake consistently and steadily. We ask Allah to help our brothers and sisters around the world under oppression. We ask Allah to help our brethren around the world that are under tyrants, that are under the shells of bullets and bombs. We ask Allah to protect them and their families. We ask Allah to accept their martyrs. We ask Allah to bring peace and tranquility to their lands. We ask Allah to have accepted and raised our ranks in the month of Ramadan and to allow us to continue the blessed honor of being of those that graduated in the month of Ramadan. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه ولا تكفروه وأقم الصلاة.